So some of you were probably here when we did this 2 years ago after Sochi. This is just Natty asked if we'd come and do a little update, some of the things that changed, some new things that we tried, some things that we did the same way again and wondered why. Lots of different things sort of came out of it. Hopefully there'll be some new information today, and for those that weren't here, we'll pick up on some new stuff. Our objective was we continue to move everything, pretty well everything, over IP connectivity. For those that don't know, we do the Olympics as a full remote production. Our studios spaces are in-country in Rio, and our control spaces, our control rooms, our support facilities, our EVSs, intercom matrix, everything are at home. So I think that's a key starting point to this. So imagine studio floor down there, everything else back here, all the guts, all the brains, other than transport. So we tried a bunch of new things this time. We went with a new IP workflow. We went out to tender and we bought Nevian. It was our transport product, which was a new experience for us. It was a new experience for them too, sort of in this style of deployment. So we both learned a lot together. It went really well. We had some real growing pains, but in the end, it went really well. It was a good product. It worked well. There's some things that we need to work on. For us being down there and living it, the meld of IP and network people designing and then broadcast people trying to work with it, that the interface was what we found was just sort of little gap there. But it's coming along well. We dabbled in 4K, and I'll let Brian speak to that more later. It was a partnership with Olympic Broadcast Services, OBS. Those countries or broadcasters that wanted to take it, but the original creator of that 4K was actually NHK, and they were producing it in 8K, and we were all down converting it. So that's the original source of that content. You want to do the last couple?
Yeah, sure. We'll talk a bit about file transfer and any kind of learning that we have around file transfer versus a baseband kind of transfer. We had a lot of learnings again about the complexities around file transfer. Digital production and distribution, we didn't go away from what we've done in the past with our partnership with a company called DeltaTray for the app and website. We'll go into that. Business continuity, what happens if something goes wrong? We'll talk about what we did to plan for a disaster. And then alternative production facilities. This is something kind of near and dear to my heart. Taking all the content that we get from OBS, we get a lot of it, and we only get to broadcast a bit of it on traditional television. We stream everything, but we don't really produce everything. So all the stuff that's streamed raw is just that. It's a raw feed coming right from the Olympic broadcaster. So this time, with support and sales from our revenue teams, they sold a couple of products that I thought were pretty cool, and we implemented them very inexpensively. So it's kind of like, how can we take all the content that we're getting and make inexpensive niche products to go to Canadians? And then we'll talk a little bit about just some insights and conclusions, and the warning that there are some eye charts in here. Mm-hmm. So you've been officially warned. Don't squint at the screen.
So just as we go through to sort of make things clear and understand how we had to deploy in country, there's the Rio Games were kind of broken into four regions. The Copacabana Zone, which was where beach volleyball, a couple of other sports, marathon, other things happened down there. Maracanã, there was some stadiums and some other sports here. Deodoro was a very remote location, which had a fair number of sports, but not a lot of sports that we tend to invest in heavily. And then Baja was the main broadcast location, or what we call the Olympic Park, which housed the IBC, our studios, and a significant number of the, I'll call them, venue sports, structure sports. So that's kind of the breakdown of the area. We had most of our people living in the Baja area, a few people deployed in Copa, only 3 people living in Deodoro, and nobody in Maricana, because we could commute simply to those locations. So that's how we deployed.
So this is this is how much we did during the Olympics. The last number we're not sure about, so don't quote that, because I've heard numbers that are different than this, but I lifted this from another presentation that we have questions about that number. We did over 500 hours of television coverage in both Toronto and Montreal on CBC and Radio Canada and all of our partner channels, TSN, Sportsnet, and RDS. We did a number of radio hours, and then everything underneath that is non-traditional web, VOD. We did partnerships with Snappy TV and Facebook, and I think there was some YouTube stuff that we did. So a big machine doing a lot of content all at home. I keep going.
Yeah.
So telco. This is how the signal kind of got back. There's a graphic after this that kind of shows the path. We had 2 10 gig circuits between the real pop and Toronto and Montreal. That went over Aldea. The first leg of the link was level 3 through OBS. This guy, ignore for just now. These are all the node locations that you'll see in another graph that come back to the IBC. So actually, just skip to that. I'll talk about it from that. That's the link that goes through. So that was the path it took on leg 1, went through continental US to Toronto. This one seemed to be a little more reliable just because it didn't go through as many pops. This one we had a little bit of problem with. It did go down a couple times, and so we were failing back to this one quite a bit.
The night before opening ceremony?
Yeah, that. So, go to the next one. So, very similar to the last diagram. Anyone that saw the Sochi one, it was just the map was on top. But we were going north to south this time. So each one of these circles here represents what we call a node. It's a venue. So, you know, what's a beach volley, the opening ceremony stadium, cycling,
swimming,
all these guys would have a little mini fridge of gear with Nevi and stuff in it. But mainly the most important thing in this rack of gear is a switch that has 1 gig connectivity back to the IBC. From the 1 gig connectivity from the IBC, we go 10 gig back to Toronto and Montreal. And then there's a 10 gig between Toronto and Montreal as a tertiary backup in case one of our legs go down, and that's how we did our hilly switching. 60 sources from here, the IBC and all the venues, were decoded in Toronto and Montreal. So production had a significant amount of resources to choose from when they were doing their shows. So much so that we think, I'm skipping ahead, but we think Korea could probably be an all-encode model, so we will never have to choose what we bring back.
Just to clarify on that, OBS gives us way more signals than we can afford to send. So we do a cut down in a router, normal sort of workflow. But because the Olympic, we had to build this time to be big enough for the summer because there's so much more sport. But as we've invested in our hardware and now we're moving back into a winter, which is much more important to us and bigger for our market, we can actually technically afford, hardware-wise, to encode it all and deal with the switching and managing of that content here at home, deciding whether or not we want to trap it or not, that kind of stuff. I just mentioned the lines too from the nodes that come back. Brian talked about we got all this other connectivity from Aldea and different places. This connectivity here is provided to us at a cost, is provided by OBS. It's an OBS service, just like any other booking audio circuit or whatever. We, for those who weren't here last time, we now sort of look at OBS as a telco. You know, give us the connectivity, where's the switch, and that's it.
Partner connectivity. So once it was here, we had to interface with TSN, Sportsnet, and RDS. This was more traditional kind of connectivity. We, with the help of Mark, booked some lines to TSN. We used our existing Sportsnet connectivity with the partnership that we have with them in the building. And RDS did the same thing as TSN in Montreal. The difference was we did do a little bit of gig-y lines there, and we ran some ARVON.io for intercom, and we ran our tickers there as well so that we could have a uniform ticker kind of and navigation presence across all the channels. The one big thing that was different this time around was our coordination, and you're best to talk about this. We did a little thing in Studio 40, which was really good.
Yeah, last time it comes down to communication, I think, and you'll hear me say that a lot, but last time we brought in two people from each partner, from Sportsnet and TSN, and we set them up with a position on the floor, and they had a router panel and an intercom panel, and we thought we were doing things right. And it went really well, and we made great relationships and good friends and stuff, but this time we wanted to take that a step further because we wanted them to be more integrated in not just, you know, the process, but also how we get to the decision, why we're making the decision. So what we did was we took a control room where we did all of our resources together, and we moved our partners right in there with us. We had one person from the CBC staff who had to make the final call, but we could all work as a group. Everyone could work as a group to see as venues came online, because this time, as opposed to Sochi, the partners were able to use our mix zones or our locations, our remote lines. So it was important that they were, you know, had confidence in the lineup and that they were part of that, because in the end, it meant that all of us had a better product. We were going to air with more confidence. We knew what we were coming out of and where we were going to. So we created we took control room 40, and we did a lot of things with it on top of that. So we had our partners in there. We had our intercom matrix in there. So the one person that was controlling all of our ARVON ports all across all the venues, IBC, all throughout this facility, connections with partners. There was one central position that did all of comms, two shifts, one person, and a support person for the early days. So that was a huge success because it was one point of contact. It also took the intercom completely out of the control room for the mainnet broadcast. There was no communication, you know, I'm not hearing so-and-so with your main production control room, which was a significant success.
It really meant that the show could concentrate on the show.
Just the show. Whereas we tend to, you know, have one person doing both of those jobs. So we felt like that went really well. Also in there, Brian will get into it in a bit, but we had the specialty products that Brian mentioned. We brought that into that space so that they could have a sense of the flow and where things were going, as well as digital. Last time we did this, digital was still kind of doing its own thing. And we saw things that we thought we could help them with that was more traditional, faxing, checking, when to open the line, when to close, things that, you know, we didn't feel were clean during Sochi. So we moved a control person in for them into that space too. So everybody that kind of had an output, we put in that room. And it was very successful.
So audio. This is, I think, one of the places that we knew we needed to, I don't know, innovate isn't the right word, but fix. We had an issue with Sochi that we probably did tell the story. There was a person down at the coast and someone in the mountain. They both wanted to commentate on the same feed, but the way that we had integrated it, the muxes were in country at the particular where the mic was. You can't have them in two different places. They had to choose. So it was whoever had the bigger market share got to commentate. The other person got international sound only. So we knew that was not good. We knew we needed to have a location agnostic commentary system. So what we decided to do was bring all the audio, regardless of where it comes, back to one single source. That point was Rio. And we put in a multi-layer router that could do muxing, and everything went into that with Matty. Any on camera, that would be embedded right at the source, at the camera.
And For unilaterals.
But those were the only on cameras that we had. And all the multilaterals, we figured with our audio experts that we could have about half a second of latency before anyone really could tell. So first real bad eye chart. There's a zoom on this. So what ended up happening was we did a calculation. We got 80 milliseconds of network latency. It's a pretty simple calculation. You've got VO booths in Toronto, Montreal. The source was in Rio. Signal comes to Toronto or Montreal. We commentate. Maddie goes back, gets embedded in the signal that actually just came to you, and then comes back with your voice on it. So we just strip the voice out here when you're calling on it, and it ends up here nice and clean with your commentary on it, and it's gone to and from Rio 3 times by the time it ends up back in country. That was about 240 milliseconds of latency, and it worked great. Our master control individuals could choose if it was a commentary booth in Rio for English, and French had a commentary booth in Montreal. It didn't matter. We just choose those two sources. They'd all go back to Rio and then come back one signal with both languages on it. So with the Rio VO booth, it was much simpler than that. It was a Rio VO booth, or OBS's audio or commentary audio would just come one way with 80 milliseconds of latency. That really let us, this is the actual implementation of all that with the router. So you can see all the different MADI sources coming into it, the directory of all that, and we've got your CBC and SRC talkback, comms, MDS was an OBS provided commentary system, Rio voiceover booths, all these things went to the router, and then on the top layer of the router would get muxed in with the video and come home.
The reason that all this is important is it gave production the flexibility. We're always trying to reduce costs, and we're looking, their production's often looking at commentators that can do multiple sports, or, you know, the logistics of getting one person from point A to point B. So say you have got a commentator and you really want them to be on site at swimming, but you also want them to call a sport that was happening out at Deodoro, and there's not enough time to get them out there to call that sport, or you don't want to spend the money to buy a commentary position from OBS for a one-hit wonder production. So you could run them back to the IBC, use a voiceover booth in the IBC, or say you have a really great commentator who's going to do a whole bunch of sports for you, and it just all of a sudden makes no sense to actually send them to Rio. You can put them in a voiceover booth in Montreal, they can call all of those different sports and stay there all day, and then send that voice down there, mux it, send it back. So no matter what the source was, it arrived in this facility ready for use in a completely uniform
And multilingual way.
Yeah.
Right? It allowed English and French to produce separately, but together. So they could choose to do whatever they'd like. You know, I'm going to be here, you be there, it doesn't matter. It all comes back to the one cycling line, and English and French for cycling comes back on that line. Done.
So we had that number of sources. You had Rio commentary positions provided by OBS. You had Rio IBC voiceover positions. Montreal voiceover booths, Toronto voiceover booths, and we also took a service from OBS called the MDS, which was OBS's calls that they were producing for other international broadcasters. It was only available in English. So we chose to take that, and with the idea that we would use it on our digital platforms, we would use it on some mainnet stuff, our partners would use it. This was not a huge success. The timing of it didn't always work out the way they said it would or the way we anticipated.
Technically, it worked flawlessly.
Yeah, fair, very fair. The other thing that was important in that was the calls. What may be an acceptable slang in my country may not be in the country, you know, may be different. Maybe that person that's calling is from Australia or England, or and something that's totally socially acceptable to say on the air there. Well, no matter what, our listeners are going to think that that's a Canadian commentator and they've said something offensive. So that became a production challenge and something to manage that we were trying to deal with, something that, yeah, is probably fine in London, but it sounds off color here or doesn't line up with how we want to be represented. So there was a juggle of that, and we've always dealt with that, and we've often bought commentary from other broadcasts. We share a lot of commentary with the Australians, actually, back and forth. And so we thought this would be really similar, but it was just a little too far out.
The scheduling really killed a couple people. 4K. This was fun. Mike seems to think that it's okay all the time. Where is he? but I don't know about that. So we, like Rob said, we took NHK's 8K. Well, actually, OBS took NHK's 8K and 22.2 audio. They down-converted it to 4K and 5.1 and gave it to us on 4 3G fibers, square division, quad link. There was 35 events totaling 90 hours of UHD content, and that came from another slide, so ignore that bit. So the contribution was a 50 meg HEVC encode. It was sent to Toronto. Here it was decoded and made available to a 4K router as that square division quad signal again. I don't like square division quad. I'll say it out loud. I don't like square division quad. I don't like two sample interleave. I don't like four cables. It's insane. The scope helped us troubleshoot a couple things though. For production, we had a number of different systems that we brought in to try. Some of them were quad link. Some of them were HEVC stream capture. We ended up going with the quad link one. It was the one that ended up working after a lot of struggling. Not with the quad link systems, but with some of the other ones. And the big hiccup all the time was 60p. A lot of systems can do 30 no problem. 60 seemed to be on the threshold for most of these computer-based systems. At the end, the production was very simple. All we did was we took this 35 hours, clipped them into, or sorry, 90 hours, clipped them into the 35 events that it was, and made a 24x7 playlist, stuck our burn on it, and let it go. It worked great. No one ever, there was no complaints from the public, but it took a lot, number one, to keep this going. The HEVC, really, really sensitive to any kind of line noise, and our main path from Rio to Toronto was really noisy. And so that had a lot of problems. We had a lot of refeeds. We actually deployed a small little recorder that did ProRes in country that we had to go to twice to refeed stuff back. And I think I watched the opening ceremonies about six times. And the 4K production value, since 8K was, NHK was doing 8K, production was with, I think, five cameras and very flat. So it was uninteresting and locked off shots. So overall, 4K for us was, for me anyway, was kind of like meh. It didn't have that pop. The one time that I thought it was really great was there's a shot where you're coming out of the mountains, you see Christ the Redeemer. That shot looked amazing, wide, it looked fantastic. Everything else close up in a stadium with people judo wrestling, just the it wasn't there. You had to be right up against the screen to see any kind of quality difference. So 4K for me, I don't know.
I got to have the experience. I got to NHK and who was their technical partner? Panasonic?
Yes. Yes.
They Panasonic, they built a viewing theater in the IBC on the second floor. So one night it was quiet. I went up there and there was basketball on in the 8K and fully mixed in 22, and it was pretty cool. It was like sitting there. But the thing that was jarring as a sports fan is when I watch sports, everyone in the background kind of fades away and they're not really there.
Now you see them all.
Well, now like somebody turns to like talk to their sibling or blow their nose or whatever, and you're watching a basketball game and like they're so crisp and clear, like you feel like you're part of their conversation. So it's really jarring. You're watching this basketball game and guys going down the court, and all of a sudden you notice that somebody just waved to get a bag of chips. It was a little different. But
they need to work on their depth of field a bit.
Yeah, the depth of field it feels so big, and then sometimes you could tell the camera operators were having a hard time, finding where they needed to be in the depth of field, and you kind of go with them as they, rack back and forth through it. It was interesting. I think the one thing that's important to point out about the 4K product is, the 4K thing was sold as a test. The BDUs bought it from us directly, and we didn't have to deliver it live. So it gave us the room to breathe, try things, test, make mistakes before we sent it off to them, which was a great way to start dabbling in it. It was really successful that way.
Mm-hmm. But I'd really like the HEVC stuff to start working with. contribution, and then everything in the stream world, it never needs to go into baseband, but I'll get to my IP ramblings later. No, that's just a whole bunch of, we implemented like four different systems in a router with quad to link it all up. All this cabling for me should be an HEVC contribution or even H.264 contribution source in, a computer running a playlist, and then playing it back out HEVC or H.264 to the BDUs. You don't need any of this cabling. But that doesn't work yet.
But we had it.
But we had it.
Brian's favorite thing.
File transfer, you go.
Oh. So, file transfer for us is not awesome yet, but getting there. The pipe coming home is fast. But baseband's still easier, kind of thing.
For certain applications.
And with sport, I think it's kind of the main sort of process is still there for that. We had some great success with file-based transfer. Our colleagues in Montreal had great success, our news and sport groups, but it was more based on the hardware and the infrastructure that they have in their facility is not the exact same as ours, and they were able to move the files and deal with them in-house in a way that was still fast, effective, efficient, allowed them to keep the metadata.
It really boiled down to their capital process bought their file encoding and transcoding into their production systems. Last year, ours were 2 or 3 years ago, so Toronto was a bit slower than Montreal, and that caused a bit of contention when the Montreal and the Toronto person are standing side by side in Rio.
And they're both trying to move the same content, and one guy's like, well, my people already have it, and they're working with it, and we've moved on to the next thing, whereas the other group is still, in their mind, they're still moving it, but it's actually already landed here. It's just still being dealt with. So that was a good learning experience. And the amount of processing time that it was taking to deal with it was no different than Sochi, but it wasn't fast as the guy standing next to him, so therefore there's a frustration, right? So that was one thing. So our news group just moved back to baseband, and we had the room, and we could do it, and they were still able to do their jobs. It just didn't work out the way we set out, which happens all the time, and that's fine.
And I'll make another plea for more IP. Every one of these gray boxes that you see here is something that we need to interface into a particular storage thing. So you can't read any of this because it's an iChart, but it's like EVS, Avid, and other systems. And what ends up happening is every time we move from system to system, we need another system to make it into the format of the particular system that we're going in. In a world where, you know, we're sending stuff in this nice, you know, file-based world, but when we end up here, we're still having to change it. And that, to me, is insanity, just because it's already in these ones and zeros. We need to come to a way where we're producing in a format that we can write directly to disk. And we're, I think, getting closer to that, but we're not there yet. And if you look at a baseband thing, it's, you know, baseband transfer, airspeed right into the thing, and it happens at real time. Some of these things can get bogged down if you don't have enough resources. A lot of these resources are finite. They can't spin up. They're not virtual. They're not microservices yet. None of this has happened. And it makes us really not agile enough to deal with bursty traffic, where a baseband, you're just waiting in line, and everyone kind of knows exactly what they're getting. That's the next thing, I think, for us with all this file-based stuff, is being able to handle those peaks and valleys. Digital didn't really change much from Sochi. We partnered again with DeltaTray for the delivery of the website and the app. It was OBS feeds, CBC Radio Canada, IBC router with the audio sources going into it. All that came home as baseband. We encoded with our elementals, went to Microsoft Azure, which is where DeltaTray's hosted, and then went out to Akamai. There's one thing that is left off of here. Any event that didn't come back on the IBC router, so an event that wasn't interesting to us to the point of we called it or got the commentary, we brought back in something called an IP Vanda. That was all the events coming back from OBS. So there should be, and you'll see in the next slide, a cloud that points into this as well. So we took the H.264 direct from the Elemental and made the multi-bit rate from the IP Vanda and gave that as a international sound only, so that we could encode everything and deliver everything to Canadians, just some with commentary, some without.
So the IP Vanda is a new product from OBS, new to us. It had existed in Sochi in a smaller form, but it's become something that's really interesting to a lot of broadcasters, especially smaller broadcasters that can't afford a lot of infrastructure. So it's a 20 meg HEVC, H.264 encoded signal, which NBC for a number of years now, they've been sending off to their regional cable stations to put right to air. So that gave us a fair amount of confidence in the hardware. Speaking with good colleagues at NBC, it was actually NBC that chose the hardware that for OBS to use to create the IP Vanda package. So it was a big success for us. We're going to look at, actually they do a high bit rate at the 20 and they also do a low bit rate. We're going to take the low bit rate and add it to our internal IPTV system, which we're going to get into in a second, so that anybody can grab any one of OBS's feeds anywhere they want, whenever they want, at least for a viewing experience. They won't be able to manipulate it, but if they're working on a story and need to follow something that's not in main net or not where they're seated, they can still get it.
Mm-hmm. And the other great thing that we did this time around with digital that was new was an IP multi-view. Because we had half of our sources coming up from IP, normally what you would do in a situation like this is you would plop a multi-viewer right here, and you DA off there, and you put the multi-view in, and now you can see all the signals that are coming in, and that's what we're encoding. That's a problem when half of the signals aren't baseband. So we thought, you know, how do we get around this? So we monitored it here after encoding. So we made a couple of Microsoft Smooth streams that went to Azure, a main and a backup. And then we made another stream at around, I think, 300 megabit that was, or kilobit, sorry, 300 kilobit. That would have been a ridiculous megabit. That went to a IP multi-viewer, and we could now see IP sources and baseband sources as they were being encoded and sent out the door in one screen, which was nice. So nice they wanted to keep it, so we made it happen. So that's the eye chart for digital. There's your IP Vanda that went in. There's the router in Rio. There's a bunch of audio manipulation. For redundancy this time, we didn't do an N plus N. We kind of did an N plus N for our broadcast feed, so you know, CBC, TSN, Sportsnet, RDS. But all the multilaterals, it was a law of diminishing returns for failure. If we lost an entire city, you would actually lose some sources. If you lost one box, we'd have enough capacity in both cities to still maintain what we wanted to do for all of our multilateral raw signals. And so it wasn't fully N plus N. That saved us a bit of money. And what we
A lot of money.
And what we ended up doing was to send our signals back and forth, we actually encoded them twice, one in an Elemental, so our N plus N, and another in an AdTech encoder that sent a backup IP source to the other city.
So what we did is we chased with the backup decoders, the AdTechs, we chased what the main nets were doing, Sportsnet, us, TSN, we chased them with those other decoders so that no matter what was live.
Yes, it is. Perfect. Go.
Oh.
Right. No, you're going. Go ahead. It's perfect.
So no matter where they went, we would follow with that backup decoder. So instead of having those sources there all the time, it took a little more work and a little more traffic and a little bit more to manage, but it was a significant financial savings. So did you guys deploy that on the resource team to chase that?
Yeah. So that resource team that Rob was talking about in 40, they were making sure that whatever was on air at that particular network was backed up through the IP Vanda. So we'd have our main transmission coming back on the Nevian system, and then we'd have a backup source in the wall that was hot, that was IP Vanda. So you could actually see them side by side, a J2K Nevian, and then a little bit more latent H.264. And I actually had a couple producers walk by and I did a test. I said, which one looks better? They're like, I don't know, they look the same.
So the important thing in all this is, well, it's all coming in the pipe. Well, it wasn't all coming in the pipe. The IP Vanda, we brought home via NBC. So we took the IP Vanda to NBC in Stamford, and then they handed it off to a switch of ours that we deployed there, and we brought it up to Montreal or straight to Toronto?
Both.
Yeah.
So on a layer three link back.
Level three link back. So it was a completely separate source. And
although we did have routers there, so it was also layer three.
Yeah. The other thing that we don't have in the slide, but just to talk about relationships are important, is that no paper signed anywhere, no nothing, but we made an agreement with NBC that we had an output of their router sitting in our router, and they had an output of our router sitting in it, and we didn't even have any infrastructure built in North America to deal with this problem. But if one of us had a catastrophic failure, we know that between level three and the 9 million distribution companies that are sitting in their racks in Stamford, that we could get each other back to North America. And that was, you know, part of our continuity. You know, we'd at least get a source out, or two sources out, or over time we could build more if we needed to. So we put fiber in between NBC's CER and ours really early on in the plan, not even knowing what we were going to use it for, but we just knew that we were going to support each other. And that is, you know, we're not competing against each other, we're two separate markets. And that really helps out for us and for them. And everyone, you know, we all still think of NBC as this giant machine and this giant beast, and they are, but, you know, they have a new owner and Comcast is looking at the books, and, you know, Olympics doesn't have a free ticket anymore. So they're coming to us with ideas about being efficient and making decisions together, just as much as we used to feel like we were knocking at the door, you know, hey, can we do this together? And that's really helped out on the business continuity side. It's been a really good relationship.
Alternative production facilities. So this one I love. This is all the content that comes back that we didn't use in the past. And the Stadium Experience Channel was one really cool thing we built with almost like gaff tape and chewing gum, but it worked amazingly for the 16 days. It was on during live sport for the entire time, and we built it with an inexpensive switching unit. I'll let everyone think what that inexpensive switching unit was. Free CG, so it was Caspar CG, closed caption encoder, a microphone, inexpensive orchestration software to tie it all together, and X keys for buttons to push. Essentially what it was, we followed the live Canadian performances as they went through the day. If there was no Canadian source, we'd roll something back from an airspeed. This thing here was more expensive by orders of magnitude than everything else in the kit. So you could replace this with something else and it'd be great.
It was pre-existing.
It was pre-existing though, so we borrowed one, a one channel. And it ended up being an X key panel about this big. It had transitions for all the different sports that we were going to, and you would choose a line on the switcher where that sport was. You'd choose the transition that you were going to. You'd cue it, and then transitional logic would just take over when you hit take. The producer had a little, and the come talk to me about the inexpensive orchestration software, because this guy's pretty cool. He wrote us a little Java applet that ran on the producer's computer where they typed in what they were about to say, because we needed to take it from sport to sport. That was the only commentary that we had on it. Everything else was stadium sound. But we wanted it to be, we called it the Air Canada experience. So just like they tell you to, you know, put your seatbelt on in both languages, we were going to tell you where we were going in both languages. And I think it was, Jonathan said it was the first bilingual broadcast that the CBC had done since, I think, the 30s or something. So the producer would type in English first and then in French what they were about to say. They'd store it in their little Java applet. And then when the person hit cue, the switcher person hit cue, it would do the switch, play the closed captioning back, and open the mic and close the mic so the person could talk, and it was all in time. And it was just two people, a producer and an operator, sitting there following Canadians for the entire day. So it was kind of like having the best seat in the house for the entire Olympics. Only TELUS bought that, so if you're living out west, you could watch it. And lots of great feedback over like Twitter and social media that this was the coolest channel. I thought it was the coolest channel too. And then other things that you could do. So Olympic Moments was sold as, it was just a rebranded service that we bought from OBS, the Olympic News Channel. It's a 30-minute wheel of content of what's going on around the Olympics. We just stuck our logo on it and shoved it out the door. But another example of an even lower cost thing that you can just rebrand some content that OBS is already making and sell it as well.
The thing that's important about all these things is that OBS provides us with more content as part of our deal than we can actually distribute. And there's been things left on the floor in the past that there's no way to capitalize on because the cost of spinning something up to do it or, you know, produce it is too high versus what you would actually get for it. So we're able to come up with some products that were based on content that's already being generated. We just need to manipulate it a little bit, or brand it a little bit, or, you know, affect it in some way, and then send it back out the door. And this allowed our media solutions team to go back out and sell more, which, you know, hits the Olympic bottom line directly. Allows us to keep doing things. So when we can find these key little things that we could spin up at a relatively low cost, you know, that's real revenue.
Really low cost. I think all this stuff was under, we the closed caption encoder we already had, the airspeed we already had, but the rest of the stuff was well under 10K.
Plus labor.
Including labor. I'm cheap. Go shipping.
We thought, not a real technical thing, but we thought important to, we didn't have anything in shipping in the last time we did this, but shipping is a significant part of what we do and how we manage the games, and we need to beg, borrow, and steal stuff from everywhere. We don't want to buy it, you know, and if you need to rent it, that means you just rented it for 3 extra months on the front end and 3 extra months on the back end, and you're paying for it to sit in a container. So there's a lot of work and effort that goes into, you know, making smart decisions that actually have nothing to do with producing television. It's about where can I get it, when can I get it, how can I get it back. We've got a great guy in Montreal, FX, and another great guy here in Toronto, Dave Alexander, who spent a lot of time working with us about how we're going to do this, and if we steal this device from here, whose device am I stealing to backfill it so I don't have to pay for it. And we just thought we'd put it in. It's interesting. We sent 3 40-foot containers from Montreal, 5 40s from Toronto. That's primarily because the sets are done here. So the sets take up a lot more volume. Most of our technical facilities this time were built in Montreal, so a lot of the early shipment of the IBC racks, tables, chairs, cable,
the telecom equipment,
venue gear, all departed from Montreal. So just a thing to think about, really, is all that it's really about is the logistics, and then the super expensive things we bring in late.
Or the stuff we forgot.
Or the stuff we forgot or didn't even know we needed.
The whoops.
Insights and wins. An insight that we continue to learn about, and I feel like I like to wave the flag that the Olympics is doing a really, really awesome job, is we are a multi-language country and we are a multi-language company, and we need to share these resources. And the thing we've learned is the more we work together, the more efficient we get, the better our relationships get, the better decisions we make. It's just really important. Like the Sochi was tough, and you know, we all came out, you know, a little bit better, but this time we went in as good as we came out the last time, and now we're that much better. Like it's really key. Like there's nobody I think on Brian's staff or my working group that would hesitate for 2 seconds to pick up the phone and call Montreal. And I haven't been here, I've only been here 8 years, but from what I'm told, that didn't exist a long time ago. And we're proud of that. That's been really good. Movement of master control to Canada. So to explain, I drew our IBC space and figured out where all the rooms were gonna be and all this stuff, and we drew in a master control. Well, partway through the process, like 4 months before we shipped, we came to the realization there was no need to have master control in that country at all. We deployed a Miranda router that we already owned.
Which can be remotely controlled.
Which can be remote controlled from anywhere. we still had master control operators, so we still had those people on the payroll, but we didn't need to fly them, feed them, house them. So they actually, they were set up at a table in Montreal in an office, could have been anywhere on the planet, plastic card table, monitors in front of it, intercom panels and some router panels, and away they went. The important thing in that is that they were cutting and manipulating sources for all three locations plus all the venues. So whether Montreal had a request for an audio source change on a multilateral, or Toronto did, or we needed something different in the IBC, everyone's still just hitting a key. Those people just happened to be in Montreal, and to get people to stop thinking about where they were at all, we just called it Olympic Master. So most of the production people, I'm sure there's production people that still have no idea
where they were talking to,
who they were talking to, or where it was. That was another big thing. I keep getting back into communication, but the first few days of that was really rough. But as soon as we got our resource people and started developing a relationship with our master control people, it was like fun times on the intercom. You know, things started going really, really well, and it was purely just about communication and asking and building relationships. It was good.
IPTVs, you love it.
I do love IPTV. We finally got to deploy some IPTV in our Olympic plan. There's some
not a lot, like 30 channels.
Yeah, it wasn't big. We took a process that a couple of our plants in Halifax and Moncton had already done, and essentially deployed a very similar process. No rocket science, nothing special about it. But what it did do is it allowed us to give sources to people that were removed from, you know, router lines, or they could control their own destiny, or listen to audio on an actual source that, you know, nobody else where they were cared about. We're going to expand it significantly. It was mainly built to support everybody in the IBC. We did not deploy an RF system in parallel with it, although I did find a box of stuff that a maintenance person had sent in case it all failed. They didn't. Somebody didn't think it was all going to work out. But
really?
Yeah. So we deployed the IPTV system, and we had a small, you know, LCD display scattered all over the desk, and everyone could choose their own destiny. And production, you would have thought that was, you know, the greatest thing in the world, because there were so many sources there. There was all kinds of sources from home that were there that normally we wouldn't pay the encoding cost to send that source back down there. But because it's, you know, relatively, it's pennies on the grand scale to send those sources back down there.
And whatever about production, on the maintenance side and the technical side, we had access to all the multi-views in all the different cities. They went into the IPTV system. So when we were having problems in Montreal, we could, without calling someone in Montreal and saying, hey, did line 3 go down over there? We could just look up and see Montreal's multi-view, because we had some cheap encoders that we brought everything back, and it was in the IPTV system. So at your desk, wherever you were, you get a phone call, something happened, you bring up the multi-view in Toronto, the multi-view in Montreal, and you can see, oh, it's just a path problem, because, you know, Toronto's good, Montreal's bad, or vice versa. Or IBC is good, and both Toronto and Montreal are bad, maybe it's an encoder. So it allows you to, you know, root cause the problem a lot easier, quicker, because you're not talking to anybody, you're just seeing all the information in front of you. So putting the right stuff in the IPTV system is really important.
And those are sources, who would ever pay to put a multi-view back on a transport path?
We did in Sochi.
Well, only for...
yeah, like two.
For key things. Well, there was a lot of multi-views in there. So you could, now you could not only help solve the problem, but you could support your colleague in a different location, because you could actually see what he was looking at too, or what he was dealing with. So if our colleague in Montreal, Philippe, had an issue, well, you know, we could say, well, okay, we can still see it, and we see that you don't have it, but we see it in Rio, and, you know, it cuts down the problem solving process.
Great troubleshooting.
That much more.
Automation of tasks at every step. We're still doing this more and more. Utilizing the OBS broadcast data feed. So Montreal did some really cool work with EVS and with repurposing a widget from DeltaTray to do automatically updating metal boards, so a CG op doesn't have to type in who's winning. And the shot listing information that came into the EVS from the OBS BDF feed was amazing. It was all in English, so it was not super useful like it would be for us. So, you know, you'll see in the next slide that we're going to try and see if we can do that with Avid. Specialty channels, content streams are continue to be a really good source of revenue. And then Rob saying.
Yeah, I wouldn't say it's my saying, but just I was thinking about what were some of the insights, and, you know, you try and plan for the best, plan for the worst, and I would say after these games, you know, something will go wrong, and my learning from this one is be ready for that, because you don't know what it is, and just be ready to be flexible. That was the biggest thing I took out of this. We had every issue that we had in Rio was a logistics issue. It was moving people, moving gear, getting into venues to build equipment, security. Unfortunately, the local organizing committee was poorly underfunded and trying so hard and just amazing attitudes, but they didn't have enough money to actually do what they were tasked to do by the Olympic Committee, by OBS, by us as broadcasters. We put a lot of stress on them, and we expect a lot. So we had a lot of issues. Like, I had people that didn't have breakfast for 2-3 weeks. I had people that had their rooms fill up 2.5 feet of sewage. I had people that were, multiple people that were on different bus accidents. I had people get stuck in places that couldn't get home. We had people 3 hours to get out of a venue because there was no buses, but you couldn't go out into the street because it wasn't safe. Gear couldn't be delivered on time. You know, the idea of being efficient with gear and using it at one venue, and when you're done moving it to the next venue, well, seemed like an amazing idea. Well, at 4:30 in the morning, when you still haven't left the first venue, it doesn't feel like a great idea anymore. So, yeah.
And our gear's just getting back now.
Yeah, our gear just arrived this past week. It's well over what I would consider to be about 3 weeks late. Logistics there was a real challenge, and sport-wise, everything went amazing. OBS did a great job. They really did. Like, all the challenges we felt with the logistics, they felt threefold what we felt. And they still managed to, I think, make most of the broadcasters happy. Every broadcaster meeting started with somebody from the local organizing committee starting every sentence with sorry. Literally. And that was the state of the nation. So it was a real challenge. And you got to a point where there's a lot of broadcasters trying to help out other broadcasters because they know they're in trouble. There was one broadcaster, no matter what they did, the organizing committee and the telco could not get them an ISDN. Well, two of us came together and we had them going through 4 different countries to get home over an IP connection in like 45 minutes because they brought it up at a broadcaster meeting. We had a way to get them out. You know, there was a lot of that kind of stuff went on because the committee was just, you know, very optimistic but understaffed and underfunded.
So some of the stuff that we want to do for the next games, more pre-wiring and pre-building. We're constantly trying to shorten our time in country. More IPTV for Rob. He loves it. Investigating an all-in-code model, which could let us possibly remove master control and leave audio assignment up to a resource individual instead of a master control person because there's nothing to really switch. We're reevaluating the types of skills sent to the site all the time on a staffing level, which Rob deals with mostly. We're seeing a trend to more, you know, computer network support. We always need more Wi-Fi, more network ports. This is what we're seeing now instead of I need another camera or I need another baseband line. We send lots of that stuff. They want more of this other stuff now. Communication improvements. This speaks to what Rob's been talking about the whole time. Most of our problems are due to people not having the correct information. That's what it comes down to almost 80% of the time. It's not a technical fault. It's that person didn't know. So we're constantly investing in communication and how we disseminate all the information so that everybody has what they need to do their jobs. More automated tools, not so that we can get rid of job functions, so that we can have job functions do more craft kind of things that, that humans can do. If the information's already being created, let's see if we can use it and let our shot listers do Canadian content instead of that was a goal, that was a shot, that was a hit. That's already being done. Let's say, you know, that was Sydney doing something that we're interested in. Multi-views. I noticed this in Toronto and Montreal. There's like an insatiable need for multi-views for all the production guys. So this kind of ties into the IPTV system.
I would say technical guys too.
Yeah, yeah. Well, the technical guys are always satisfied with their multi-views because we always get what we want. We're the ones building it. But the production guys are always needing, I want this, I want that, I need to see these particular sources. This ties into IPTV for me. With a big enough IPTV system, multi-view becomes self-serve. You just choose what you want to see. It doesn't work at a control room level because you need that quick latency. But at a, I need to see, you know, all the networks plus all of us just to do my job, that would ride IPTV in my mind. Shortened venue and remote cabling and setup times. I know Rob's got some ideas about, you know, sending some teams in parallel on that one. Space reduction is always important. OBS charges a ton of money for every square meter of space. We want to investigate remote camera control that works and that's affordable, Dave. Numeris encoding in the field and stream domain. This is for counting. Right now we do everything with racks and racks of boxes. And we're seeing more, you know, how do we do a stream? How do we do a VOD file? And so we want to start getting really efficient with our counting encoding. And IP, so, you know, Ethernet connected devices, we want to use them. We're really not interested in other stuff. If it doesn't plug into our switch in the node, it's kind of useless to us. We don't want to put another adapter thingy in the way. Miss anything?
The only thing I think we missed is one thing we're planning for the next games is we're looking at, we haven't decided yet, but we're looking at doing our own commentary. Mm. And we're looking at IP-controlled commentary systems, truly just in the test and discovery phase, but what that would allow us to do. We've always done our commentary with OBS. Everything in our world is riding on that node, and that node is our device sitting on OBS's, we'll call it telco service, back to the IBC. Well, if we lost that, our commentary comes to us through OBS anyway, so we still have a show, and we've always, it's a decision about, you know, leaving our commentary with that keeps us safe, and we still have a show. If we move our commentary, which would be a significant cost savings in the long run, it wouldn't be on game day one, but in the long run, we would save a lot of money, have a lot more control, be probably a little more efficient in our setup and fax time. But you're now everything's riding in one basket, so we need to weigh that out.
And we actually don't know, once it crosses the OBS threshold, it could all be running the same telco circuit. We don't know.
Yeah.
But it just seems like there's that added little benefit. We bought this commentary circuit from OBS, and we bought this EPL from OBS. At the end of the day, they could be traveling the same circuit to get back to the IBC. We don't know, but we feel that they're two different things. And we would be collapsing all that down into our service. So why our technical teams are great, I put this in here just to thank Nadia, because I give her stuff like this, which is not detailed at all, really. It looks like it's detailed, but this is like every system in the building, and I kind of just tell her to make it work. So, thank you. And then a rant about the move to IP. So these are spreadsheets that another colleague of ours, Paul, does, that defines the router ins and outs that we require. There are different sections with, you know, the feeds coming in, the feeds going out, stuff that feeds multi-views, stuff that goes to partners. Each one of these things is a cable, a destination on an RF system, a frame sync, a this, a that, a, you name it, it goes through the plant. And all this stuff gets temporarily wired or reconfigured for every Olympics that we do. There was like hundreds. With an IP system, you kind of just demark the multicast addresses at the door, and it's kind of configuration at the end of the day. It's not rewiring. It's not RF, it's not this, it's spinning up virtual devices to do a transcode and do an IPTV source. It's spinning up a device to take that stream and write it to Avid, take that stream and write it to EVS. It's configuration, it's not rewiring, it's not tracking, it's not stealing from Peter to pay Paul. which we do all the time. So this complexity I want to see kind of go away with the move to IP. Things like muxing audio in a stream world, we should be able to do that. We shouldn't need a big giant router to do these things. So we're excited about the move to IP. It can't happen fast enough for me because I'm sick of doing these spreadsheets with Paul. Questions?
So you mentioned the multi-viewers that you were sending them around. Were you able to select audio for, let's say you have 16 windows, were you able to select a channel of audio on window 12?
On the IP multi-viewer we were with the particular product we chose.
And the audio channel?
It would, you could, you could tell it, you know, which channels you were listening to. You could solo, I think, a channel, but you couldn't do, like, multiple channels. So you couldn't listen to a stereo pair in that particular one. But we're seeing more and more software-based solutions that, you know, have features like that. You know, it's just a new point release on a piece of software now. You don't have to go back and buy a new thing. All of our baseband multi-viewers, they have that ability, but because they go to everybody in the building, it's not a for you. It's a for everybody. So normally what we do is we choose, you know, like on the one for Toronto, CBC Main, that's the one that's audio on it. For the one from Montreal, it's Radio Canada's audio is on there. For TSN one, we'll choose the first TSN channel is the audio that's on there because it goes to so many places. If it was just for you, we would give you the interface that lets you do it on some of the baseband units that we've got. But with an IPTV kind of, each person gets their own, you're choosing what you're listening to. And we just need to find the solutions that have that particular audio soloing and mixing capability. But the one that we had, you could choose, and you could solo individual audio or listen to it all.
What was your the driving decision to go with Nebion instead of the Evers that you did 3 years ago?
Our RFP process. And they were the successful candidate after the process ended.
But technically there wasn't anything.
Technically they checked all the boxes that we put out there. So after the evaluation, technically they fulfilled it and they were the winning vendor.
Are you using the same network pipes for the live feeds and file based network?
Yes, and we had QoS in place to deal with that.
Question on the 8K stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Was there any feedback from the guys over in Japan as to, was it good, was it?
I didn't hear anything, but you were there.
Yeah, never dealt with, you know, I listened to the hallway chatter in the IBC and that's as far as it ever really got for me. You know, a lot of people, you know, mentioned the same thing that I just spoke about, you know, trying to follow the, you know, the play. Well, there's all this other stuff going on that you can actually now focus on. That was the biggest thing. We know that the reason Brian spoke about the cut being really flat and sort of basic, it's not produced like we would produce something. It had very few graphic elements, you know, no
locked off cameras.
Yeah, very like steady, you know,
C level positions in the stadiums.
There. Yeah, and their camera operators
weren't there. There was no camera operators.
We're not, you know, but even near play by what we would call play by play, you know, pan, no pushing. It was very, very basic. So, you know, to start seeing some real movement and, you know, what we would do on hockey or basketball or soccer, that would, in North America, that would be a little more interesting to me. The amount of processing time and to move that content back to the IBC and stuff, I did hear, and this is total, you know, word of mouth, that it did take them longer than they anticipated to deal with getting the content and then getting it down to 4K and moved out to the broadcasters that bought in. I think there was only four broadcasters that actually took the 4K via OBS from NHK.
Was there any 4K production?
NBC did opening and closing in 4K with HDR.
With their own cameras?
With their own cameras, their own hardware.
you're protecting your backup. Were you using the 2022-7 for that, or were you more manually switching?
For the hitless switching?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Like, were you using hitless, or were you using
it was hitless.
Okay, so you were...
But it was J2K hitless, so...
It's the same thing.
Yeah.
And what kind of, like, path differential between... Like, you had one path that went under the ocean and one up the...
One that had 74 bus subway stops?
Yeah. they weren't... There was a longer path, but the longer path wasn't significantly longer. I don't actually know the numbers.
Any good ballpark idea?
Maybe 15-20%. Going once? Going twice? Cool.
Last three time.
Oh, oh yep. Yeah. Last second.
Sorry. You mentioned this stadium online experience. Mm-hmm. Was that something that was available online?
No, it was the stadium experience. It wasn't available online, just TELUS. So you had to be...
So that's something sold to...
Sold to TELUS directly, sold to OBDU, and they spun it up on Optic and their other stuff, and people watched there.
Do you see you guys...
So VR we left out of here because it wasn't really, but it's not super interesting. We bought VR from OBS.
Which OBS bought from Samsung,
right.
Kind of. In
so you could have watched, though, the Rio Olympics had VR. It was a VR app on the store that you could download for
both stores.
And you could watch it. It was interesting, but we purchased it and out the door it went.
We purchased it, they put our branding in it, but we never really had to touch it. So every country or broadcaster that purchased it, you know, put your burn inside it in the corner, or your landing page was done per what your specs were and your look. But then after that, it was generic for everybody. So we, from our point of view, CBC did VR, and the public thinks that we did VR, but from our perspective, we didn't really
do any VR.
Do the VR.
Now, but speaking of VR, one interesting thing that I kind of would like to use 360 for is that sense of place for production, not for the consumer.
Oh,
so,
because
there's a lot of, and not for the cameraman, really, for like guys like Rob or the producers or whatnot. If we had a little, 360 jobby on each one of our cameras. Where am I? Okay. Can you grab that and put it into what? So that'd be interesting. I don't know. More
control
gimmickly.
Control issue.
Yeah, maybe a little bit. Don't do that.
Can you just use your left hand?
What if it's on your
left?
Put one of those in my son's head. VR was, we asked OBS after, like, how did the other countries, how did it go? They said it was well received. We've already asked, are you going to invest in VR again? Will we be looking? Because we're already trying to work with our media solutions team on what we're going to go out and sell and not sell. And it looks like VR is coming back. It doesn't appear as though the investment is any greater. They're not going to deploy a significantly large, it's going to kind of go with it as, it sounds slow rollout is what.
Well, also there's the issue of standards with VR.
It was weird on the Android side.
Yeah, because you could get what's the special Samsung?
The Gear.
Oculus.
No, it was Gear and Oculus. I think we did support it on, and it changed like 30 times during the. And I stopped paying attention.
When OBS wanted to get into it, they were sold one thing by one company, and then it didn't look like the company was going to deliver. So OBS got cold feet. So they started looking at another vendor, and there was a lot of back and forth that had. Everybody that had already subscribed and had already had their team sell it, what's happening, where's it going? There was a lot of,
But at the end of the day, it worked on your iPhone, it worked on my Note 4, it worked on my OnePlus.
Yeah.
So it worked on a bunch of things.
Because I was in Rio, I couldn't see ours, even though I was off our network. The phone knew that it was in Rio. So even though I was tied to our CBC network, and there's not a device in our facility.
Can turn your GPS off?
Even when we turned it off, unless it got turned on,
again.
Oh, really?
In another location. So if you brought a phone down and turned the GPS before you turned.
Right, okay.
It would be fine. But when I fired it up, luckily, Globo, the Brazilian broadcaster, so I had the exact same app, but it had the Globo branding. But I had no way to convince my phone that it was in Canada. So I couldn't get it. And I was trying lots of tricks.
Cool.
I got to ask the question. Any 3D?
No. That died with FIFA.
Ryan, thank you.
Thank you.
Howard, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.